Welcome, everyone, to our fourth Pediatric Hospital Medicine podcast here at Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh. Let's do our disclaimer. This podcast is for general informational educational purposes only and is not to be considered medical advice for any particular patient. Clinicians must rely on their own informed clinical judgments when making recommendations for their patients. I just want to remind our listeners that there is free CME credit available courtesy of the University of Pittsburgh. If you just follow the link in the description of this particular podcast and just answer a couple of questions, you'll be sent your free CME credit, and it's Category 1 AMA, Category 1 CME. So please remember to do that. All right, now that that's out of the way, I'm Dr. Tony Tarchichi, your host again. Just to recap, I'm a member of the Paul C. Gaffney Diagnostic Referral Group here at Children's Hospital in Pittsburgh. I'm an assistant professor at the University of Pittsburgh. This is our fourth podcast, and this time I've tried to do something a little different, being that we're getting out of and finishing up, God willing, with bronchiolitis season this winter. I've decided to try to do bronchiolitis for this podcast. Now, in full disclosure, this is a topic, if you're a pediatric hospitalist and listening to me, you know a lot about, you talk a lot about, you deal with. So the challenge was how to make this interesting. So I've decided to do a review of the literature for only the past 3 years. That's as far back as we're going to go, and that will be how I think we jazz it up to catch everyone up in case you haven't been able to keep up with what's going on in bronchiolitis. I have nothing to disclose, but at this time I'd like to introduce my guest this week. This is one of my colleagues, an excellent clinician. Her name is Dr. Sylvia Choi. She is an associate professor at the University of Pittsburgh. She is director of the observation unit at Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh and director of the feeding center. And she's one of my colleagues at the Paul C. Gaffney Diagnostic Referral Group here at Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh. Sylvia?
Hi, thanks so much for inviting me to come speak with you and your guest, Tony. I have no disclosures.
Okay, so this is how we're going to do this week. We're going to walk through pretending that we have a patient through each article with each step you would make to see them in the hospital, see them in the ER, etc. So before they can go to the hospital, they have to be born. So we have a genetics article to talk about is our first article. And I think you'll like where this is going, but we'll see. So this is from Scientific Report 7. It's article number 41653 in Nature, January 31st, 2017. It's called Genome-wide Association, Study of Polymorphisms Predisposing to Bronchiolitis. Now, before we talk about this article, I want to discuss an interesting point about this study. Here is the point. This study told me that in Finland and Sweden, clinicians have begun to consider bronchiolitis to be mainly a disease of infants under 12 months of age. Before we talk about this article, I have to be honest with you, this surprised me. I know I have some listeners in Sweden and Finland, so I didn't know that there was actually a debate in terms of when is bronchiolitis bronchiolitis. So because it surprised me, and this may be my own ignorance, I decided to do a little bit more digging. And the article that I found that best describes this debate is back in Acta Pediatrica, Volume 103, Issue 9, September 2014. And it's by, and let me, this is a good time to do my disclosure. My other disclosure is I am going to butcher names that we are talking about. And I apologize to the authors or their friends or family if they're listening, or anyone who's offended if I butcher anyone's name. So I'm going to say that blanketly for now. The article is Diagnosis and Treatment of Bronchiolitis in Finnish and Swedish Children's Hospitals. This was interesting because this was a study that was created to describe the current practices for bronchiolitis in Finnish and Swedish hospitals. It was done via a questionnaire and on a diagnosis and treatment of bronchiolitis in children below 2 years old. And it was sent to all Finnish and Swedish hospitals providing inpatient care for children. All 22 of the Finnish hospitals answered and 21 of the 37 Swedish hospitals answered. And neither country has national guidelines for diagnosis or treatment of bronchiolitis, according to the article. So the questionnaire that was made up, it was made up of about 6 or 7 questions, the age limit for diagnosis of bronchiolitis, the practices for measuring O2 sats and respiratory rate on admissions, indications for the administration of bronchodilators or corticosteroids, practices for giving inhaled saline, and if it's given, the concentration and the indications for starting additional oxygen and treatment with nasal continuous or positive pressure airway, And the attendings were asked to list, using their own words, the five most important clinical findings in bronchiolitis. In this study, in Finland, the majority, 71% of doctors, considered 12 months as the upper limit for bronchiolitis. Why this is so different? Because I've always assumed everyone except the 24 months old to be the upper limit of bronchiolitis, or more appropriately put, 2 to 24 months as the age range for bronchiolitis. This was a little surprising. In Sweden, 35% considered 6 months as the upper limit of bronchiolitis, 26% considered 12 months, and 28% considered 24 months, respectively. So it's split more across the board. And the study really states that there's no widely accepted age limit for the use of bronchiolitis as a diagnostic label worldwide. So here in the U.S., we really accept 24 months, but worldwide, that's not the case. So that is the interesting part for the genome study that took me on a little side trail that I've just taken you on. Sylvia, did you know about this worldwide discussion as to the upper age limit for bronchiolitis?
No, I think like you, I typically think about first time wheezing a child less than 24 months of age. I think that sometimes we think more 12 months of age and younger, but I definitely except up to 24 months, and I think we've all seen that even older child who doesn't quite fit asthma, and we call it the infamous asthmalitis, because it may be a combination of the two, but that is interesting that there would be such a discrepancy in Finland.
Yeah. All right, now back to the genome study. Just to remind you, in case you've forgotten, this is the genome-wide association study of polymorphisms predisposing to bronchiolitis in nature. We know that there's already several congenital and environmental risk factors for which predispose someone to severe bronchiolitis, like prematurity, age less than a month, immunodeficiency, congenital heart disease, tobacco smoke exposure. But these are risk factors really don't fully explain the variation in disease severity. That was the theory behind this paper, that the host's genetic factors likely contribute to the severity of viral bronchiolitis in the patient. And the purpose was to conduct a hypothesis-free genome-wide association study to identify genetic polymorphisms that predispose in an infant to viral bronchiolitis. We already knew that certain polymorphisms in genes, including IL-10, IL-13, TLR4, VDR, CCR5 and ADAM33 have been associated with both bronchiolitis and asthma. And that could support genetic predisposition to both infant viral bronchiolitis and subsequent asthma. Also, we know that an increased risk of childhood onset asthma after rhinovirus infection has been associated with 17q21 locus. So in the end, I'm not going to walk you through the exact details of the genetic study because I couldn't do it any justice at all. But in the end, they studied a Finnish-Swedish population of about 217 kids hospitalized for bronchiolitis and 778 controls. They did not detect genome-wide significant associations, but several suggestive association signals were observed in this genome-wide association study. They felt that some of the limitations were obviously small sample size, but it brought up an interesting question to me, and Sylvia, I'm going to ask you. Would this information, if we could identify individuals who were susceptible to bronchiolitis, would it help what we do?
I think in the perfect world, when we think about trying to prevent disease, that, yeah, if you could say without a doubt that there would be a child who you know would be very susceptible to significant bronchiolitis, then you would say, well, why don't we target that child with Synagis, right? So that, to me, could be helpful, but I think that would be years down the road. I can't imagine that we are going to have that level of genomic testing in a relatively short period of time to make it cost-effective to use Synagis.
I agree. Synagis was my first thought as well. I wonder, once we found the genome or the specific polymorphisms that really made someone more susceptible, would then Synergist begin a study right away? And the answer is probably yes, but who knows? All right, so the child's born. Our imaginary patient is born, and now we're taking them to the hospital because they may have bronchiolitis. So what we're going to talk about now is pulse oximeter, oxygen association. This is an article in The Lancet, September 12, 2015, volume 386, by Steve Cunningham et al., called Oxygen Saturation Targets in Infants with Bronchiolitis, BIDS, B-I-D-S, a double-blind randomized equivalence trial. So this study was done because even though the AAP guideline on oxygen states there's the clinician may choose not to administer supplemental oxygen if the oxyhemoglobin saturation exceeds 90% in infants and children with a diagnosis of bronchiolitis, and that's one of our key action statements, and the WHO agrees with the AAP's recommendation on oxygen saturation, the UK SIGN, or Scottish Intercollegiate Guidelines Network, along with BTS, the British Thoracic Society, recommend a target pulse ox of 90, greater than or equal to 94%. This is another thing I honestly didn't know, and this just goes to how much I should be reading, is that the worldwide, again, this oxygen saturation level of 90% that we kind of accept because of the AAP wasn't or isn't fully accepted worldwide yet. I think it's starting to, but there's still a debate in the literature as to what the right number is. One of the reasons was the WHO recommendations are considered more pragmatic advice for the best use of scarce oxygen availability in lower resource settings. And neither the AAP or the WHO's recommended targets have, before this study, been tested in a randomized controlled trial. So this was a parallel group, randomized controlled equivalence trial at 8 pediatric hospitals in the UK during two separate six-month winter bronchiolitis seasons. Now, to more understand the UK recommendations, you must understand that the British Thoracic Society has guidelines for community-acquired pneumonia and asthma. In their guidelines at this time, 2015, they set oxygen saturation for when to start oxygen at less than 92% in community-acquired pneumonia and less than 94% in asthma, or equal to 94%. What I'm about to say here is pure speculation on my part because I couldn't find it in print, but likely because of the association and the polymorphisms that we saw between asthma and bronchiolitis, they said, well, we'll use 94% for bronchiolitis. But if anyone, especially if you're a practicing pediatric hospitalist in the UK, want to email me, please feel free. I'd love to learn more. So the primary outcome of this study was time to resolution of cough. They had 615 infants recruited of median age of 21.3 weeks. And the way they actually did it was interesting. This was really interesting. They had a computer program randomly allocate a sequence. So infants were enrolled by clinicians and either researchers or specialist nurses in the hospital ED or acute assessment area, and then a group allocation was concealed until definite enrollment. Then, mostly the nursing staff, attached either a standard or a modified pulse oximeter, which looked exactly the same according to the computer-generated randomization code. They were attached roughly within at least an interval of at least 1 minute after the removal of the hospital oximeter that was in the ER acute assessment area, and within 4 hours of arrival to the hospital. There was a time limit that had to happen. Mostly they were attached at the point of preparing the transfer from the hospital ER to the hospital floor. Now, you have to understand the monitors were exactly the same except for the study number. So the average difference between displayed, standard, and modified oximeter value was 2%. And everyone involved was masked to study intervention, and the mask was not broken for any infant during the study. Normally, in the UK, if you were a physician at this time taking care of a child, if the pulse oximeter went below or equals not 94%, you'd put on oxygen. So for this study, the algorithm on the study pulse oximeter skewed the displayed values so that a measured value of 90% really on the monitor would display 94%, with the displayed values above and below this point. So if they were 90%, they would put 94 on the monitor, so the physician didn't know the difference. And that was only on the study monitors. The other monitors were normal. And once they got to 90, they would switch back to normal. That's how these study monitors work. Study staff then followed up participants and parents or guardians during the hospital stay, and also by structured telephone questionnaire at 7, 14, and 28 days, and then 6 months after randomization to assess outcome. I hope that's clear. I thought it was a great, I mean, it just seemed like a really nice design. The results were 615 infants were recruited, 307 were monitored with the modified study oximeters, 308 were monitored with standard normal oximeters. The characteristics of the two groups were similar, except that the modified group with the fake oximeters had fewer boys and more infants were preterm. 70% of the standard group infants and 76% in the modified group tested positive for RSV. And then if you look at some of the results, the mean time to cough resolution, which our primary outcome, was 15 days in both standard and modified group, with a median difference of roughly a day. And the groups were considered equivalent for the primary outcome. And there was no difference of note were found in the pre-specified subgroup analyses for time to cough resolution. One of the other things they studied was a return to adequate feeding. And infants returned to adequate feeding 2.7 hours sooner in the modified group with the fake oximeters. Infants in the modified group were considered back to normal one day sooner by the parents. And these two specific things really surprised the authors. Time fit to discharge in the standard group with the normal oximeters was 44.2 hours. In the modified group with the fake oximeter was 30.2 hours. Time to actual discharge, I assume walking out of the hospital, 50.9 hours in the standard group, 40.9 hours in the modified group with the fake oximeters. Time to no further supplemental oxygen, 27.6 hours in the standard group and 5.7 hours in the modified group. So in every median, in everything we looked at, the modified group either did better or the same as the standard group. And at day 28, the pulse ox values did not significantly differ. A post hoc analysis done for the difference between time to event outcomes suggested that the modified group might have benefited more. So there's a little bit more here. Supplemental oxygen was provided to 223 of 305 of the infants in the standard group and 169 of 304 in the modified group, which makes sense. The oxygen values were lower in the standard group to start oxygen. Now, early discharge did not result in parents in the modified group having greater levels of anxiety. They actually asked them. At 7, 14, or 28 days, they were fine. And primary caregivers discharged sooner in the modified group actually lost fewer hours to usual activities like work, etc., than those in the standard group, and that's kind of obvious. The serious adverse events and regular adverse events were recorded up to 28 days after randomization. They recorded 35 serious adverse events in 32 infants in the standard care group and 25 serious adverse events in 24 infants in the modified group. In the 28 days after randomization, 173 events were recorded in 144 infants in total. The standard group of that was 89 adverse events in 75 infants. These are regular adverse events, not severe or serious, sorry. In the modified group, it's 84 adverse events in 69 infants. And there was, importantly, no difference was noted between the groups for the type of event or severity of the event. The PICU admissions, there was roughly 8 in the standard care group. What was interesting is the readmission to the hospital. The standard care group with the normal pulse oximeter had 26 readmissions to the hospital and one prolonged hospital stay. The modified care group with the fake pulse oximeters had 12 readmissions to the hospital, which is significantly less than 26. And time to readmission did not differ significantly. That really surprised the authors more than anything else, because they really discussed it. Now, in terms of cost savings, the modified care group showed roughly a $496 mean cost savings per patient, which was associated with the modified oximeters over the study period. Now, I don't want to get political in any way on the podcast, but I will say that this was done in the National Health Service and the UK, and that overall, their health system is a little bit cheaper than ours in the United States. I believe, without any real data to support it, that the cost savings in the U.S. would probably have been higher. Now, they did discuss in the discussion section why they thought the standard care group had a slower time to return to oral feeding. Their thought was maybe the nasal secretions were being dried out by the oxygen gas and the increased resistance to nasal airflow created by the cannula to deliver oxygen made the kids feed slower. Like I said, they were surprised by the readmission rate. They gave a potential reason for this is the infants who were in the hospital longer might have had a greater risk of nosocomial infection or possibly oxygen toxicity leading to readmission. Now, this isn't the first study to imply that children with bronchiolitis have better outcomes when exposed to fewer interventions. Basically, when we do less, we get more. One of the bigger ones was in a New England Journal in 2013, done by Skirvin et al. I apologize for that. And it's racemic adrenaline and inhalation strategies in acute bronchiolitis. So that was a lot. I'm going to stop for a second. I'm going to ask my colleague, Sylvia, did this surprise you at all? Finding out that the less we do and the less oxygen is on, the patients do better, they feed quicker, they leave the hospital faster, they're less likely to come back. Did you expect this level of a difference between the groups?
I think the staying in the hospital less time makes perfect sense, right? Because we are not holding them to a higher standard. We are allowing them to have that permissive hypoxemia, which we all in the U.S. think that is safe. And because of that, they don't need to return closer to baseline in order to go home. So the shorter hospital stay did not surprise me. It also didn't really surprise me that there was no difference in the readmission time, because I feel like those children were just as safe as the kids who had to be at 94%. I guess that the parents' perception they were better was interesting to me. And it may be that, you know, we make these kids vulnerable, right? So when we put oxygen on them, when we do things to them, the parents perceive that they're more ill. And when we try to normalize their bronchiolitis, then many times I feel that the parents get less nervous because we say to them, oh, this is exactly what we would expect them to be doing. And so while I was a little surprised to see that the parents felt like they got better sooner, maybe it's because we did not make the patients look more ill by sticking oxygen on them.
Now, if you listen to these podcasts at all, you know I normally try to do something to break up these articles, and that this is a podcast, so there's no jokes I can show you in terms of a meme. I've been doing bad dad jokes, and I've done quite a few of them. I'm going to do George Carlin jokes. I think he's a great comedian. So the first one is one of my favorites. Have you ever noticed that anybody driving slower than you is an idiot? And anyone going faster than you is a maniac. So now, in our imaginary patient that we have, they've been born and they've gone to the hospital and got the pulse ox on them. And the next question is, if they're in any distress, what intervention should we or should we not do? For that answer, let's look to our next article, and it's titled, Association Between Hypertonic Saline and Hospital Length of Stay in Acute Viral Bronchiolitis, a reanalysis of two meta-analyses. And it's by Corinne G. Brooks et al., published in JAMA Pediatrics 2016, I think it's issue 170, volume 6. Now, this study was initially done, and Sylvia, you may remember this, the Cochrane Review was initially done for hypertonic saline back in July 31st, 2013, by Zhang L. et al. And it showed that the patients treated with 3% nebulized hypertonic saline had a significantly shorter mean length of stay compared to those treated with 0.9% nebulized saline or even nothing. And what was interesting about this is within our group, we had discussion at that point as to whether or not we should begin using it as a standard regimen for our bronchiolitics. Why don't you talk about what we decided? We kind of decided we didn't believe the data at that point, right?
Right. So I think what's interesting about bronchiolitis is that it's been around forever, and we love to do things. And so anytime there's a new therapy, Lasix for bronchiolitis or inhaled steroids for bronchiolitis, you know, we all get very excited that someone has found the magic cure. And what I think has become apparent over time is that there's no magic cure. And so anytime there's new evidence of something that seems to be miraculously effective for bronchiolitis, it makes everyone sort of take pause and think, how could it possibly be that no one has figured this out before, right? So I think that we as a group had felt that while we did not delve into the papers like the Cochrane Review team had done, the data was too good to be true. And so I think that that was why we had decided, and we had looked at other children's hospitals' guidelines for bronchiolitis, and they were also not jumping on the hypertonic bandwagon. So I think with a lot of things in medicine, sometimes trying to be careful with your approach and trying to think not just let me read this one paper and see what it says, but let me think clinically, how does this make sense, can save us from doing things that would not necessarily be the most effective.
And for me personally, this paper was very interesting because in training, I had kind of been taught to really look at Cochrane reviews as somewhat of the end all be all. Excellent papers, really, you can take it to the bank. And this paper really, for me, was a bit of an eye-opener. This study was done because the previous Cochrane meta-analyses done on hypertonic saline, which we've talked about, had significant heterogeneity reported across the studies included. Now, you could be asking, like I was asking, what is heterogeneity? So this is a statistical measure, obviously, of observed variability between study results. And specifically, it's a measure of the likelihood that the variability is due to something more than chance. So multiple studies showing very, very different things, could these be due to something more than just chance? In the studies included in the original meta-analysis back in 2013, the mean length of stay in the control groups varied from 1.8 to 7.4 days across 15 studies. So this is excessive heterogeneity. And if there is excessive heterogeneity, you should be really careful and investigate the possibility for differences in study design, population, or characteristics of the intervention. The included studies in the Cochrane paper were randomized clinical trials of hypertonic saline, 3% or 5%, versus 0.9% saline NEBS, with or without any adjunct medication use, like bronchodilators, or of hypertonic saline versus standard care in hospitalized children. And the primary outcome was length of stay. They repeated the same search strategy used by the Cochrane Review in the Medline database through September 2015, which was longer than the Cochrane Review, obviously, and they didn't have any previously unidentified studies. So the studies were all the same. The data set they pulled is not as important, but it's study year, setting, sample size, control group, mean length of stay. They also extracted out any factors which contributed to the heterogeneity that we just discussed. This included study level factors like admission and discharge criteria, adjusted adjunct medication use and treatment frequency, but also individual level factors like the day of illness at study enrollment, severity of illness score, age of the patient, and then treatment group level factors like imbalance between treatment groups and individual patient factors. Respiratory distress scores were standardized. Then, to evaluate this effectively, they pre-planned the following steps. This gets a little technical, but the first part's really, for me, the linchpin. They did a pre-planned, the first step was a qualitative survey of the articles looking for a potentially important difference in study design and associated sensitivity or subgroup analysis of those factors. Looking at the study design and seeing if it's good, seeing if there's differences. The next thing they pre-planned, the next step, was a single variable meta regression against each of the following variables: control group length of stay, use of adjunct meds, treatment frequency, day of illness at study enrollment, remember that one, clinical score, mean age. Then there was a multivariate meta regression against variables found to be significant contributors to heterogeneity in the previous step. This is where it got technical. Meta regression extends standard regression techniques to meta analyses to examine heterogeneity and the association between the potential moderator variables and treatment effect, but allow the inclusion of continuous variables. So the results. I told you 18 studies were included, which was 2,063 infants, 63% were male, with a mean age of 4.2 months, with a mean length of stay of 3.6 days. It was found in this reanalysis that two of the studies performed in the same center in China, which had strikingly different criteria for hospital discharge. The Chinese studies were criteria for hospital discharge was 12 hours without respiratory symptoms, which is far more stringent than any other trial. This population really was a statistical outlier for length of stay. The new study verified there was no appreciable differences, this new review, in severity of illness in this population through a comparison of normalized severity scores at the study entry. Also, most of the roughly more than 70% of the children enrolled in these studies were receiving systemic corticosteroids prior to admission, and those were rates not seen in any other study. So once you remove this study population, these two studies in the same center in China, the original Cochrane Review's heterogeneity improved to a level considered moderate to acceptable. For people who understand this, the I-squared decreased from 78% to 45%, and it made the summary weighted mean difference statistically insignificant. So therefore, this means the results are sensitive to the inclusion-exclusion criteria of this population. There was also baseline differences between the treatment arms in the day of illness at the study enrollment. Now, this really resulted in a systemic bias favoring the treatment group because patients who presented later on in their illness were more likely to be allocated to the hypertonic saline treatment arm in 6 of the 18 studies included in the original Cochrane Review, including most of these small positive studies. And that really skewed it towards looking like hypertonic saline was maybe doing better. As you can imagine, like we just said, this is a probable mechanism of bias. Makes sense. Because we know bronchiolitis lasts a certain amount of time. If we get in later, it'll probably wrap up all by itself. One of the most interesting findings of this study is that it stated the study's representative of a U.S. population did not show any benefit from hypertonic saline. Again, that's interesting to me because I work in the United States. So hearing that makes me feel like, okay, we were right, and hypertonic saline just doesn't work for people as much as we were hoping it would. So, in summary, hypertonic saline, as per this re-review, cannot be expected to shorten length of stay in bronchiolitis in typical U.S. hospitals. The appearance that it may have is due to issues that we've discussed and really the study design and the Cochrane review. So, that was interesting. So, Sylvia, what are your thoughts?
So, this is a question. You don't have to put this in the podcast. Did the Cochrane review go back and re-look at what they did after this was...
I just Googled them today.
Because that would be interesting, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Because you're right. I think that we sort of think about the Cochrane Review as being all that, but they're fallible just like the rest of us. But I just wonder, it would have been so helpful because this was such a great relook at something that clearly didn't make sense to other people either. And it would be I think it would help me as a clinician feel more trusting of the Cochrane Review if they took clearly like a better look at what they had done when there's such a different result from these other people.
Yeah, I just looked at their website today. I haven't found anything, but that makes sense. I mean, if they looked at the study, and I don't know if it's that they meet periodically and they can't do it right now. Maybe the next time they'll do it. Yeah. I kind of hope they do, too, because I do. Right. They are a very good. Everything else they've written, I believe.
Right. And most of us don't have the ability to do these big meta-analyses. We don't have the time. We don't have the statistical knowledge. So I think that it would be really helpful. I think a lot of these sources that we use to help us with everyday practice, like UpToDate, right? We really do rely on a lot of these to continually look back at what data is available. And I know they've pulled Cochrane reviews that are no longer felt to be accurate because of new data that has come out. And so just a little surprised they haven't done it with this one.
This study only came out a year ago, so...
True.
All right. So now in our imaginary patient, we've had them born. We looked at their genetics. We've got their pulse oximeter. We've ruled out using hypertonic saline. So now we're going to look at whether or not we should use high-flow nasal cannula. Now, I'm going to tell you, there's two studies here that I think are just great. They took me a while to really read through and sift through and really explain. So before we get to that, let's do another George Carlin joke. I have as much authority as the Pope. I just don't have as many people who believe it. And it's true, comedians do these jokes better than I do. All right, so this study is, next one, was in The Lancet, volume 389, issue 10072. High flow, warm, humidified oxygen versus standard low flow nasal cannula oxygen for moderate bronchiolitis. An open phase 4 randomized controlled trial by Elizabeth Keprotes et al. Now, just in case the terminology is a little different, high flow, warm, humidified oxygen is also known as high flow nasal cannula. That's what we call it here in Pittsburgh. So up until when this was written, there really were just some observational studies and retrospective chart reviews suggesting some positive effects from high-flow nasal cannula. This study was done to address the insufficiency, meaning in this case the lack of randomized controlled trials, the insufficiency of evidence surrounding the safety and effectiveness of high-flow oxygen in pediatric healthcare. So this was an open randomized controlled trial, again designed to provide clinical guidance for the care of children with moderate bronchiolitis. And they went from July 16, 2012 to May 1, 2015. The aim was to examine whether high-flow nasal cannula provided better respiratory support. This was measured by a reduction in time to weaning off oxygen. They hypothesized that high-flow nasal cannula might increase the alveolar surface area, improving the ventilation-perfusion mismatch, and reducing ventilation inconsistency. The study occurred in the ER of the John Hunter Hospital and the median medical unit of the John Hunter Children's Hospital in the Hunter New England Local Health District of New South Wales in Australia. And I believe I have some listeners in New South Wales, so I just wanted to say hello. This health district has a huge catchment area and serves about 900,000 people. So let's go over the inclusion criteria. Children less than 24 months are presented to the ED or floor with a clinical diagnosis of bronchiolitis, moderate in severity, using the NSW Health Clinical Practice Guideline and requiring supplemental oxygen. They were included. Infants with chronic lung disease on home oxygen could be included, but they were weaned to their home oxygen rate instead of room air. Kids with severe or life-threatening bronchiolitis were excluded because low-flow oxygen is not part of the standard care for these patients. The exclusion criteria. Kids with mild bronchiolitis not requiring oxygen, although they could get enrolled if they worsened and needed oxygen later in their course. Then, children with severe or life-threatening bronchiolitis as defined by the NSW Health, and that includes severe tachypnea respiratory rate greater than 70, bradypnea, if I said that correctly, respiratory less than 30, moderate severe grunting, cyanosis or pallor or witnessed apnea, O2 sat less than 90 on room air or less than 92% on 2 liters nasal cannula, marked tachycardia 180 beats per minute or bradycardia, children admitted to the floor ward after an ICU management, children transferred from other facilities if they had received supplemental oxygen prior to arrival, or known diagnosis of asthma or the presence of pneumothorax or nasal trauma. Now here's, for me, this is where I had some trouble with the study because this exclusion criteria looks like a lot of kids I would put on high-flow nasal cannula where I am at in Pittsburgh now. I wrestled with this a little bit, and I think what they're trying to do is see if high-flow nasal cannula would benefit kids not in severe but just plain moderate distress. So that's why they really wanted to include the disclude the severe ones. But do you agree, Sylvia?
That's what it sounded like to me. I agree with that. But you're right. I think that the patients that they excluded would have been good candidates for the treatment.
Now, to be deemed requiring oxygen, you had to meet one of the following criteria: abnormal heart rate, abnormal respiratory rate, decreased O2 sats, or increased work of breathing. The patients were stratified according to gestational age. Those patients were started on maximum standard therapy using 2 liters per minute cold nasal cannula wall oxygen while further clinical assessment occurred. Then the children were randomly assigned according to gestational age to either standard therapy or high-flow nasal cannula. Standard therapy for this study and according to the study in Australia incorporated cold wall oxygen 100% via infant nasal cannula at low flow rate to a max of 2 liters per minute. The wards used humidified oxygen. So the experimental arm was high-flow nasal cannula delivered via age-appropriate Optiflow Junior nasal cannula and the MR850 humidifier using a max flow of 1 liter per kilo per minute to a limit of 20 liters per minute using a 1-to-1 air-to-oxygen ratio. For O2 sats, a reading of 94% or less indicated the need for additional oxygen. So for this study, they followed the British Thoracic Society's recommendations. Weaning of oxygen was permitted after 3 hours on max therapy. The study protocol stated that children who deteriorated on standard therapy could trial high-flow nasal cannula at the 1 liter per kilo per minute as a rescue therapy in the ward or transfer to the ICU or on critical care high flow or CPAP or IPAP. So everyone in the study got RSV testing and what amounts to our standard respiratory virus panel, which is the standard panel all over the world. There was a follow-up phone interview with parents 30 days after discharge. So the primary outcome was time to weaning off oxygen. Infants who died, transferred to another hospital, or withdrawn from the study by parent or guardian were censored. So the primary outcome is time to weaning off oxygen. The secondary safety outcomes, time from randomization to treatment failure, proportion of treatment failure, proportion of serious adverse events, transfer to the ICU. Secondary effectiveness outcomes were length of hospital stay, baseline adjusted heart rate and respiratory rate at 4 and 24 hours. They determined that to provide 80% power to reject the null hypothesis that no difference existed between the two treatment arms, they would need a total sample size of about 202 children, randomized 1-to-1. There were also parent-reported outcomes collected through the follow-up phase with a phone interview that we just talked about. The results. Initially, 1,170 kids less than 24 months old presented to the ED with a primary diagnosis of bronchiolitis, and 753 were admitted for management of that. Of that 753, 449 had moderate bronchiolitis requiring supplemental oxygen, and 395 were eligible for the inclusion in the study. 54 were ineligible because they were transferred from other sites with oxygen in progress. 202 kids were enrolled in the study because that was what they figured they needed for their power. 101 randomly assigned to either high-flow nasal cannula or standard delivery. There was another 181 who retrospectively appeared eligible but were not offered the trial for unknown reasons. Baseline characteristics of the 202 enrolled children, like age, sex, gestational age at birth, weight, viruses detected, breastfeeding, tobacco exposure, etc. They were balanced between the two groups. The ED staff collected the nasopharyngeal aspirates from all 202, and RSV was detected in about 57%, or 116. Rhinovirus was 47%, 95 kids. More than one infection was in 27%, which is about 54 kids. And of the other viruses detected, adenovirus was the next highest with 10% or 20, then human metapneumovirus at 18 or 9%, parainfluenza 2 and 3, then flu A and B brought up the rear. Time to weaning off oxygen did not differ significantly between the standard group and the high-flow nasal cannula. The standard group was 24 hours to wean off, and the high-flow was 20 hours. They had to calculate the 24-hour event-free survival to summarize the proportion of children who survived 24 hours without experiencing treatment failure. 90% of the high-flow nasal cannula group remained free from treatment failure at 24 hours compared with 60% of the standard therapy group. The difference here was statistically significant and really favored the high-flow nasal cannula. The proportion of kids who experienced treatment failure was higher in a standard group than in the high-flow group. Now, to break down these kids, they really went through quite a bit of detail. So 33 kids were not supported by standard therapy. One child became distressed, didn't tolerate having the nasal cannula in place. She then stabilized. The 32 remaining kids trialed high-flow as a rescue therapy for their deterioration. Of 12 of these kids required transfer to the ICU after continuous deterioration. And then high flow reversed the deterioration of the other 20 kids who stayed in the floor. So no serious oxygen-related adverse events like pneumothorax, pressure injuries, or bleeding occurred, and no child died. So there was 4 adverse events recorded, 2 in each group. In the high flow group, one infant was found to have only room air connected to the humidifier, resulting in a brief period of desatting. Another infant inhaled condensation from the circuit during transfer, so they changed the standard therapy and he did fine. In the standard group, the 2 kids on standard therapy experienced oxygen tubing disconnection from the wall outlet, resulting in brief periods of agitation before their oxygen tubing was reconnected. Those were the adverse effects. 26 children required ICU admission due to progression of severe bronchiolitis. 18 of the 26 had RSV, and we know there's a risk factor for severe bronchiolitis. And that's what this study really said, that it kind of supports that RSV really, it continues to contribute to a more severe form of bronchiolitis. And they did quote an article, which I looked up, which also said the same thing. Review of Epidemiology and Clinical Risk Factors for Severe Respiratory Syncytial Virus, Journal of Pediatrics from 2003. So they started talking about health economics in the article. They assumed that the ED ward and ICU care-related costs per patient were similar in both arms of the study, given the results. The cost of high-flow nasal cannula was about $80 per week per infant. Standard therapy costs were about $5 per week per infant for just the cannulas. So after accounting for the consumable costs and any ICU stay, standard therapy would have required additional resources at about $300,000, whereas high flow required fewer resources at about $135,000. So to summarize, they found a statistically significant and clinically important effect of high flow nasal cannula in delaying the time of treatment failure and reducing the number of kids who experienced treatment failure. Now, one of the things they talked about was the weaning protocol in this study. And they found that the weaning protocol itself actually decreased how long these kids were on oxygen. And they said that the independent effect of the weaning procedure appears significant across both arms, as median time to weaning off oxygen reduced from a historical 38 hours to just 24 hours for the standard therapy group. The oxygen weaning procedure appears to be a low-cost, clinically efficient method of reducing healthcare burden. And I got that. This was a really nice commentary on the article itself, which I read by Steve Cunningham and Ricardo Fernandez. I thought it was very well written, and that was something in there. They said that if high-flow nasal cannula is used as a rescue therapy for children who are not adequately supported by standard therapy, it may reduce the proportion of children who require high-cost ICU care. So that was interesting. I like that a lot. So, Sylvia, what do you think? Do we underuse high flow? Should we use it more?
I don't think so. I think that what this study showed was that the regular cold nasal cannula, regular flow rate, is effective and is more cost-effective. However, for those patients that are worsening, the high flow definitely seems to be able to rescue them. So I think that's what we do in our daily practice here at Children's in Pittsburgh, is that if these kids have hypoxemia, we use regular nasal cannula. And if they are going down the wrong way, then we will step up therapy. Here, we don't do high flow on the floor, so they do have to go to the ICU, which adds to their cost. But certainly, I think we all anecdotally know of patients that avoid intubation because they have improved with high-flow nasal cannula. So I think that it's sort of what this study showed, that using it as a rescue for those kids that fail is probably more cost-effective than going on to mechanical ventilation for those patients.
And the kids that failed in the standard group were 60, you know, a big portion of them really failed, whereas in the high flow, almost none of them failed.
Right, but the cost of the high flow, I think, does not make it effective to use it for all comers.
And that's what made my next study really interesting, because this is and I didn't send you this one, and I'm sorry. This one just came out in Hospital Pediatrics this month. It's clinical outcomes of bronchiolitis after implementation of a general ward high flow nasal cannula guideline by Jeffrey Reese et al., Hospital Pediatrics, April 2017, Volume 7, Issue 4. What this was a study done at Hasbro Children's Hospital in Rhode Island. The goal was to assess the association of the introduction of a ward, general floors. By the way, as a side note, I didn't really realize or had forgotten people use ward instead of floor. So it took me about 20 minutes to Google this. But after I figured it out. But it was funny. So they introduced this in the ward's high-flow nasal cannula guideline and clinical outcomes in infants with bronchiolitis. Now, this is two big articles on this, and they say different things. So let's go into it. They talk about how high-flow nasal cannula therapy has been increasingly used for infants with bronchiolitis, which we know. The explanations for its mechanism of efficacy vary in the literature with multiple proposed mechanisms. So the studies done on infants in an ICU setting do note increases in end expiratory lung volumes and slower respiratory rate among infants receiving high-flow nasal cannula. And there is evidence that high-flow nasal cannula is effective at reducing intubation in both the ICU and ER. So this was a study done for the floor. This was a retrospective pre- and post-intervention of infants aged less than 24 months admitted with a diagnosis of bronchiolitis to Hasbro Children's Hospital between 4/1/2010 and 3/31/2014. The hospital admits about 600 bronchiolitic patients annually, just bronchiolitis. So they initiated this institutional guideline for high-flow nasal cannula on the general wards in March 2012. So if you're keeping track, that's right in the middle of the study period. So 2 years of the study period was before the guideline, and 2 years was after. So that's why it was a pre- and post-intervention. So what did the guideline state at Hasbro? They stated that a patient could be initially admitted to the ward on high-flow nasal cannula therapy, could be initiated for an established patient on the wards, or a patient in the ICU receiving high-flow could be transferred to the general wards while continuing the high-flow nasal cannula therapy. It included guidelines for the indications, initiation, and weaning. During the years of the study, the max flow for patients was a kid less than 6 months old. The max flow was 8 liters per minute. 6 to 18 months old, the max flow was 12 liters per minute. 18 to 24 months old was 15 liters per minute. This is lower than the max flow in the Australian study for New South Wales, but this is what Hasbro used. The ability to wean off high-flow nasal cannula is based on what you think it'd be based on: work of breathing, respiratory rate improvements, and other clinical factors. And now the inclusion and exclusion criteria. Kids that were excluded were less than 37 weeks gestation, specific diagnoses of chronic lung disease, asthma, chromosomal abnormalities, heart disease, and neurologic diseases were excluded, and children in a hospital more than 21 days were excluded due to complex cases. The inclusion criteria is anyone with an ICD-9 code for bronchiolitis, RSV or non-RSV, apnea, acute upper respiratory tract infection, and unspecified viral illness, and they were all screened for inclusion. So the primary outcome was hospital length of stay after initiation of the general ward high-flow nasal cannula guideline. Secondary outcome was PICU transfer from wards, yes or no, PICU length of stay in days, potential adverse outcomes, intubation, 30-day readmission, etc. For the results of this study, 936 patients were admitted 24 months before the high-flow nasal cannula guideline in the general wards, and 1,001 were admitted in the 24 months after the guideline was started. In terms of a baseline characteristics of the groups, the patients in the before group were a little bit younger, 4 month median age compared to the 5 month median age in the after group. And again, I say before the guidelines and after the guidelines, so before and after. And there was a significant difference in race. The after group had a higher number of white patients and lower African American and Hispanic Latino population. Now for this study, they used what's called an unadjusted comparison of the two groups and an adjusted outcome of the two groups. To adjust, they used an interrupted time series analysis applied to a generalized linear model framework, assuming an underlying binomial distribution for proportions and underlying exponential distribution for max high flow nasal cannula rate and time variables. That's a mouthful. I'm going to be very upfront with you if you're listening. I had no idea what this meant. So I did some digging. First, I looked up a couple of good review articles and I read most of them. But I emailed the author of the article, Dr. Jeffrey Reese, the primary author, the first author. He was kind enough to email me back today. So this really is hot off the presses. He admitted he was not the statistician in the group, but he said in general, by adjusting using a time series, you can control for any trends and outcome that were already in place before the intervention. For example, the length of stay was sloping downward in the 2 years before the intervention. So the continuation of this decreasing length of stay can't be explained by the high flow on the wards. The p-value of the interrupted time series measures how much slope changes in the after the intervention, so the slope of the change. From a statistical perspective, the null hypothesis is that slope 2 is 0, i.e. whatever the rate of change over time was in the pre-intervention period persists after the intervention. So if it's going down, it goes down at the same rate. It doesn't change. Rejecting the null hypothesis means that we believe there was a change in slope with the intervention. In other words, we think that the rate of change in their outcome after intervention is different from the rate of change over time before the intervention. So I want to say thank you, Dr. Jeffrey Reese, for sending me that. That was actually very helpful, more helpful than the articles I read. So that really summarized it nicely. So that explains why they use this adjusted outcome of the two groups. So now that that's all clear. Looking at the unadjusted comparison of the two groups, the mean number of days of high flow nasal cannula was significantly less for the after group, 2.0 days versus 2.5 days. However, looking at that same data, the adjusted interrupted time series model, the introduction of high flow nasal cannula on the general wards was not associated with a change in the length of high flow nasal cannula trajectory or a difference in the number of days of high flow related relative to the before group. What that means is if we look at the raw data, it looks like the high flow amount of time patient was on it was better in the after group. Using this adjusted model, adjusted interrupted time series model, there isn't a difference. And you're going to see this pattern repeated in this paper. Using the adjusted and unadjusted models, the after group had a higher APR-DRG severity levels. So the after group bronchiolitic patients had a higher severity. They were sicker. For length of stay, in the unadjusted comparison of the two groups before and after, introduction of the high flow on the general wards, both the median and the mean total length of stay for all patients with bronchiolitis were significantly reduced. They went from 2 days to 1 day. That's a p-value of less than 0.001. However, again, in the adjusted interrupted time series model, the intro of high flow nasal cannula on the general wards was not associated with a change in the length of stay trajectory or a difference in length of stay relative to the group before the trend. So they were going down beforehand and they continued to go down at the same rate. So the high flow didn't do anything. When they separated the groups into those who did not receive high flow and patients requiring high flow and adjusting using an interrupted time model, the intro of high flow in a general ward was not associated with a change in the length of stay trajectory for either group. Even separating them out by groups didn't help. Looking at the PICU data, again, in the unadjusted comparison of the two groups, before and after the intro of the high flow on the general wards, the median PICU length of stay for patients with bronchiolitis was significantly reduced to 1.7 from 2.3 days. But again, taking the adjusted interrupted time series model, there was no change in the PICU length of stay trajectory at all in the before or after group. There was no difference in the rate of PICU admission for the pre or post group or in the PICU transfer rate in the adjusted interrupted time series model. There was also no difference in PICU bounce backs, those patients who go back to the PICU once they come out. Other secondary outcomes in both adjusted and unadjusted interrupted time, the unadjusted and adjusted interrupted time series model, there was no change or difference in intubation rate or 30-day readmission rate. There was no cases of pneumothorax or other complications from high flow in either group, and there was no deaths in either group. So just to recap this study did examine, this was the largest cohort to date of patients with bronchiolitis on high-flow nasal cannula, including its use in the general wards, and the impact on PICU transfer rate and PICU length of stay. They felt the limitations were obviously it's a single site. It was non-randomized. Pre- and post-intervention study design is one that's hard to control for confounding variables. But I got to say, I think it was a really well-done study going over a statistical method I really did not know about and showed, I think, pretty well that high flow doesn't really change your length of stay, your PICU transfer rate, or the care of your patient.
Right. It just goes to show again that less is more, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's over and over again. We're seeing the same thing. Less is more, less is more. Right. These kids just support and less is more. Right.
So what's so interesting is with that study that you were describing, I wonder what that institution had done in the year prior, because they had seen a decline in their lengths of stay. Did they institute guidelines that were different? Did they change their pulse oximeter endpoints? You know, it's just interesting that they saw a decrease in the length of stay regardless of the high flow.
Yeah, I know. I didn't think to ask. That's a great question. I can email them and ask. But you're right. Maybe they instituted a pulse ox guidelines
They did something different because they cut their length of stay in half.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. That's a great question. So back to our imaginary patient. Now we've got them born. We looked at their genetics. We have got them to a pulse oximeter using 90%, the AAP-WHO model. We've looked at other particular models. We've talked about hypertonic saline. We're not going to use that. We've looked at high flow, and I think high flow nasal cannula, there's still a debate going on. It looks like the literature is beginning to tip more towards not using it, but we'll see. In terms of a possible board question, because, you know, now that we are a board-certified subspecialty in pediatric hospital medicine, one of the things we all have to take is a board examination. I don't know how they could incorporate it. We've gone over it now, so and a lot of the theories as to how high flow works are still not proven or not proven well. So we'll see. But now we have to hydrate our patient. So the next study we're going to talk about is nasogastric hydration in infants with bronchiolitis less than 2 months of age. This is by Ed Oakley et al. In the Journal of Pediatrics, November 2016, volume 178. So you have to remember, fluid replacement therapy is required in a rough approximately 30% of children admitted with bronchiolitis. The updated AAP guidelines on bronchiolitis state that if infants older than 1 month of age are unable to take fluids orally, alternative routes of fluid administration are NG hydration or IV fluid hydration, with NG feeding also allowing more physiologic nutrition, including provision of expressed breast milk or formula. Now, in 2013, this group, Oakley et al., showed that infants with bronchiolitis ages 2 months old to 12 months, IV hydration and NG hydration are equally efficacious and safe methods for hydration. This was in the Lancet Respiratory Medicine, nasogastric hydration versus IV hydration for infants with bronchiolitis, a randomized trial in 2013. And since that study in 2013, Australia and New Zealand, who we've seen in a previous study, so they're really doing a good bit of this bronchiolitis literature, you had widespread use of nasogastric hydration for bronchiolitis, as per this article. So I've not been there, and I've not been to one of their hospitals, but this is what the article says. Now remember, again, that risk factors for more severe disease in bronchiolitis are age less than 1 month, or post-conceptual age of less than 48 weeks for preterm infants. So this age group hasn't really been studied well, this less than 2-month-old age group, and that's the article we're looking at now, less than 2 months of age. Plus, there have been some papers which raise questions or concerns about NG tube placement in young infants. Could it impinge on their airway as their obligate nasal breathers? And is there a risk or increased risk of aspiration for infants with RSV bronchiolitis? So this study walks in. This is the study that we're talking about. The aim was to assess if nasogastric hydration can be used in infants with bronchiolitis less than 2 months of age. They did this by determining the adverse event profile of the infants treated with NG hydration and IV hydration and comparing this with published data on NG hydration in infants 2 months of age and older. This study took place from April 1st, 2011 to October 31st, 2013, which I just found odd they ended on Halloween. This was a descriptive retrospective cohort study of infants younger than 2 months of age with bronchiolitis at 3 pediatric centers in the state of Victoria, Australia. The 3 hospitals, Royal Children's Hospital, Monash Medical Center, and Sunshine Hospital, are all parts of the Pediatric Research and Emergency Departments International Collaborative, and they were the actual study sites of the original randomized controlled trial comparing NG hydration and IV fluids that we just mentioned earlier. So it's the same hospitals, same site, same people doing it, makes for a great study. Inclusion criteria: infants less than 2 months old are presented to the ED with bronchiolitis and received hydration via NG or IV route, started in the ED. Exclusion criteria were infants who at admission from the ED who only received oral hydration or required invasive or non-invasive ventilation on initial presentation. Primary outcome, rate of adverse event. So that's the primary outcome. And the adverse events were desaturation, bradycardia, apnea, pulmonary aspiration. Secondary outcomes, hospital length of stay, duration of non-oral hydration, ICU admission, and duration of ICU admission. Key outcomes of infants under two months old, hydrated via NG hydration were compared with previously published randomized controlled trial data on infants 2 to 12 months of age from the same study in the same area. We talked about that. Length of stay was capped at 14 days to be comparable with data from the previous study. So the results, 491 infants 2 months old or less with bronchiolitis were admitted to the participating hospitals. Of that, 250 were excluded secondary to only needing oral hydration. Then 22 were excluded for requiring invasive or non-invasive ventilation in the ED, which leaves you with 211 infants for the study. 65 or 31% received IV fluids. 146 or 69% got hydrated via NG tube, which really shows you in Victoria, Australia, NG hydration seems to be the standard, which is a complaint for the study, but we'll get to that. So on the baseline demographics and clinical characteristics, the only difference were infants receiving IV fluid hydration were younger than the NG group, 4.8 versus 5.4 weeks. Otherwise, sex, weight, past medical history, vital signs on admission, they were similar in both groups. More infants were treated with antibiotics in the group receiving IV fluids, and it was not a small difference. 44.6% of the infants receiving who got IV fluids got antibiotics versus 14.5% of the NG fluid kids got antibiotics. More infants who received IV hydration had documented desaturation below 90%. That was 15.6 versus 8.2% when first assessed in the ED. There was no significant difference between RSV between the two groups in RSV amount. The adverse frequency of any adverse event was 27.4% in the group receiving NG hydration compared to 23.1% in the IV hydration group. Remember, the definition for adverse event was pretty broad. Desaturation, bradycardia, apnea, or pulmonary aspiration. A lot of these kids at one point or another will desaturate. The majority of adverse events were desaturation. No, I shouldn't read before I talk. No pulmonary aspirations were seen in either group. Apneas and bradycardias occurred infrequently and in similar proportions in each group. More infants receiving IV hydration were admitted to the ICU, 38.5%, versus NG hydration, 19.9%. And the ICU mean length of stay were similar in both groups. More patients receiving IV hydration received any form of ventilation than in the NG group. So if you had an IV, you were more likely to have ventilation help. Hospital length of stay and duration of non-oral fluid therapy was comparable between the groups. Then they compared the adverse events, mesogastric hydration, in young infants less than 2 months old and older infants, 2 to 12 months, with bronchiolitis on the previously published randomized controlled data. The younger infants resulted in more apnea, 5.5% versus 0.3% in the older kids, with a significant p-value of less than 0.001, and desaturation, 21.9% versus 5% with a p-value less than 0.001. There was no difference in aspiration and no difference in the need for invasive ventilation. Now, and I think they discussed this. Remember, this was a retrospective trial. This wasn't randomized control like the initial trial. And it seems like in Victoria, Australia, the NG hydration is the standard of care. So it would mean, as an observer, anyone getting IV hydration is probably sicker, which I think skews a lot of this data. So I'm not sure how applicable this is to somewhere like in Pittsburgh, where IV hydration is still the standard of care. I like their initial randomized controlled trial. I think that really showed an NG hydration in kids 2 to 12 months of age really does work, as well as IV. But Sylvie, what do you think?
So I agree. I think that we tend to use IV way more in Pittsburgh. It would be nice if we did more NG, especially if more of our families were providing breast milk for our kids, because then we could be giving them something that would be a better medicine than what we have to give them. But I do think it's a little hard to generalize this study to what we do here.
I wouldn't feel safe taking this and saying we can use it on a two-week-old.
I agree. And the only other thing that I'll add is that Halloween is an American holiday. And while we may have exported it to other countries, I don't know if other countries are that happy to have it exported to them.
I thought the day before All Souls was international holiday.
I don't know. We'll have to look and see if they have a Halloween in Australia, but I think it's a U.S. holiday.
Oh, that would be embarrassing.
I mean, everyone should have it, right? It's free candy.
It's free candy. Let's see. Now, those were the major articles I wanted to go over. There was more, but we're already over the hour that we normally do. And so you will get CME credit if you listen to all of this. So thank you all for listening who all have been. Just a few housekeeping points. The PHM conference is coming up in July. It's going to be in Nashville this year. PHM is the Pediatric Hospital Medicine Conference. I will be there. I'm excited to go there. I go every year for the past couple of years. So I hope to see you all there.
So they say that Halloween is an American thing. Even though it had its beginnings as a Celtic festival, it's primarily Americans who have spread the festivity in its current form as a pop culture activity.
Okay. So my apologies to any of our Australian listeners, which I have some, hopefully. So to recap, we have discussed that the AAP and WHO recommendations for less than 90% as the pulse oximeter number to start oxygen, according to the studies that were done in the UK that we reviewed, looked like to be the correct numbers to use in terms of decreasing length of stay, decreasing patient readmission. Also, hypertonic saline was debunked in the past 3 years with that reanalysis of the Cochrane review. So it is not it does not increase length of stay. It does not decrease length of stay. Thank you. Also, we talked about the high flow nasal cannula in depth. And like I said before, I think the jury is still out, but I'm not sure its use on a general ward is necessarily a good thing. But I think more studies should be done, especially more multi-center trials. I think that would be wonderful. And then for hydration, the initial 2013 Ed Oakley randomized controlled trial in Victoria, Australia was great, proving NG hydration is as good as IV in kids 2 to 12 months of age. I'm not sure this study for younger kids less than 2 months old is applicable worldwide. And genetic polymorphisms, we haven't found anything really strongly suggestive of bronchiolitis yet, but the jury's still out. So I want to thank you all again for listening. If you are listening, I really appreciate it. Thank you for your time. And I want to thank my guest, Dr. Sylvia Choi. So we thank you for coming.
Thank you, Tony. Remember, less is more.
Less is more. And my next podcast should be within 4 weeks, and I think even sooner than that. I'm going to start veering away from infectious disease. We've done a lot of infectious disease. I'm going to do the palliative care, pediatric palliative care. We're going to run through the core competencies for pediatric hospital medicine on palliative care with my guest next time. And I think that should be great. If you have any questions, and if I said anything to offend you in any way, I'm sorry. Please feel free to email me. If you have topics you want to hear talked about, my email address is Tony, T-O-N-Y, dot Tarchichi, T-A-R-C-H-I-C-H-I, at chp.edu, chp.edu. So I want to thank the University of Pittsburgh again for giving the free CME credit to all the listeners. I appreciate them doing that. And you just follow the link on the site that you went to get this, listen to this podcast, and you'll be able to get your free CME credit through University of Pittsburgh. I want to thank my group for letting me do this and supporting me. As always, I'd like to thank Dr. Megan Keene Tarchichi, who helps me with everything. Thank you. And I will see you all next time, or at the PHM conference in July, whatever comes first. Thank you.